Ladies and gentlemen, it's April 11th, 2017 on this Tuesday Global Edition. Trump has ordered the military to prepare plans to strike North Korea. That's mainstream news. South Korea is in a full panic. The Chinese are sending 150,000 troops to the north. North Korean ships are headed home from China as China starts sanctions against North Korea. So Trump did have an effect in that meeting. We have the CIA caught staging false flag attacks in the United States. That's mainstream news. Of course, you heard it here a month ago, but it's now breaking in the Hill, and so much more. But first, Paul Watson was right about Sweden.
Remember when the media and all those lefty, lovey celebrities laughed at me for warning about mass immigration and Sweden? Yeah, well, it's not so funny now, is it? Four people were killed and 15 injured when a rejected asylum seeker drove a truck into a crowd of people in Stockholm. The culprit, a 39-year-old ISIS supporter, was ordered to be deported 4 months ago, yet remained in the country. If not for this hero who forced the terrorist to crash by driving into his path, hundreds more could have been killed. Acknowledging the total disaster that allowing in hundreds of thousands of refugees has been, Sweden's prime minister said, "Sweden will never go back to the mass migration we had in autumn 2015. Never." Well, it's too friggin' late now, isn't it? Everyone's virtually forgotten about this already, because terrorism is the new normal in Europe. The terrorists have won. Leftists think that going on with business as usual and allowing in untold millions more migrants is courageous. It's not courageous, it's cowardice. It's normalizing terrorism, because they'd rather be dead than, God forbid, be called a racist. Strange, isn't it, how people aren't being mowed down by lorries in Japan, in Hungary, in the Czech Republic? Only in countries that have imported huge numbers of migrants that share certain beliefs. Some kind of connection there. Can't quite put my finger on it. Sweden, the most progressive, pro-refugee, pro-Islam country in the entire West. A country that isn't involved in any Middle Eastern wars. And it still got attacked by an Islamic terrorist. Progressives, your submission will not protect you. I was right about Sweden. Trump was right.
Sweden, they took in large numbers. They're having problems like they never thought possible.
The migrant residents of Rinkeby pelted police officers with stones while they were trying to arrest one of the terror suspects. Oh, but no-go zones don't exist. They're a conspiracy theory. Really? Is that why PostNord just announced that they were going to stop delivering mail in Holster, just down the road from Rinkeby, because it's, quote, not safe? Rinkeby, the same suburb journalist Tim Pool was told by police to leave or he'd be attacked. The same suburb where an Australian film crew was attacked. And notice how the media treats victims of Islamic terrorism compared to how they treat victims in other situations. How many times did they show you the picture of the dead boy on the Turkish beach? How about the child victims of the chemical weapons attack in Syria? Lots of times, right? Okay, how about the dismembered child victim of the Stockholm attack? No, they didn't show you that, did they? Did they show you the bodies of the 10 dead children after the Nice attack? No! Did they show you the dead children after the attack on Christians in Egypt? No. Isn't it an amazing coincidence how we only see the bodies of dead kids when there's an agenda to be sold? CNN's really keen on giving a platform to a 7-year-old girl who's being used as a mouthpiece to sell the invasion of Syria.
Bana, do you blame President Assad for this?
Yes.
What is your message to President Assad?
I am very sad.
Jake Tapper wants you to follow her on Twitter. Are they going to give a voice to the children of parents massacred by Islamic terrorists on the streets of Europe? Yeah, don't hold your breath. Sweden's new feminist leader wants to ban deportations altogether, even of rapists, because Sweden is a racist society. Yeah, so racist that she, a black woman from Uganda, was just elected to lead a major political party. But don't worry, because left-wing newspaper Aftonbladet has a solution. Stop importing hundreds of thousands of Muslim migrants? No. Ban cars from big cities. And the mayor of Stockholm says Sweden will defeat terrorists by thinking of kindness and openness. Oh, you mean like the openness that allowed 150 ISIS terrorists to cross back into Sweden? Yeah. Good luck with that.
We'll be back, ladies and gentlemen, for an incredibly important broadcast. A passenger getting beaten up for not getting off the plane on United Airlines is the top story right now in the United States. And their stocks are down. You know what? I'm not going to cover it. It's their private property. He didn't get off the plane. I think it was handled wrong. He wouldn't get off. The cop tasered him. That was excessive, probably. But it's not as important, ladies and gentlemen, as Trump orders military to prepare plans to hit North Korea. That's mainstream news. Government tries to calm South Koreans' fear of imminent war. Reuters, North Korea ships head home after China orders coal returned. That's showing that they're punishing North Korea as Trump demanded. That is a very good sign that the Chinese and North are about to back down. Thank God. South Korea paper reports China has deployed 150,000 troops to North Korea border. Still, tensions are very high, folks. This is one of the most dangerous times in world history. Unusual Navy patrol sparks fear of foreign sub off California coast. That's up on DrudgeReport.com, a Kit Daniels story. So that's just some of the news on that front. Then, something ultra huge. North Korea has come out and threatened back and saying, we will nuke your aircraft carriers. And Trump saying back, we'll nuke you as well. So this is really deteriorating quickly. The stories are up on Infowars.com. They're also on DrudgeReport.com and PrisonPlanet.com. North Korea state media warns of nuclear strike if provoked as U.S. warships approach. Again, that is Reuters on Yahoo News. Expert, this is Infowars.com, U.S. could be planning strike on North Korea nuclear reactor. Worst case scenario, nuclear war. That is today, April 11th, by Paul Joseph Watson. And it's normal, it's some crazy government god who's a total little weakling with a bunch of slaves under him. And as usual, our government under Clinton gave him the reactors, gave him the materials, gave him everything. ABB was allowed to do it. U.S. could be planning strike on North Korean nuclear reactor. Worst case scenario, nuclear war. That's all coming up today. And I'm going to go over the clips in details. And that ties into a new story from Steve Watson. Now, you'd think this would be on mainstream news. I haven't seen it. Vladimir Putin on national Russian TV said Syrian chemical attack was a false flag, a staged event, and that more are coming. They plan to plant chemicals in Damascus and accuse the Syrian government of an attack. Pentagon cast doubt on AP report claiming Russia knew about Syrian chemical attack. That's good news. The Pentagon didn't push in war with Russia just yet. Tillerson, Russia must choose between Assad and the U.S. Well, why did our government start trying to topple Assad? And then every time Russia goes along with an attack on Iraq or an attack on Libya, the U.S. only starts more wars with Russia and then overthrows Ukraine. So Russia gets the fact that they've already tried appeasing for the last 15 years, and it's not working. Now, let's get into the real meat and potatoes, because I'm going to go back into this in just a moment and the false flag situation and the proof. But first off, look at this. The Hill is reporting on something we told you the day Vault 7 came out months ago. But now it's in mainstream news, the very same Hill newspaper that criticizes yours truly constantly. Security firm links CIA to series of past attacks. You read the article, it's what's already in the leaks, the two different Vault 7 dumps. The CIA has a bunch of tools, and they engage in operations to frame Russia, hacking into computers and launching attacks on Congress, on the CIA, on the NSA, on the Cyber Command, so they can go back to Congress and get more money. So that when the generals retire, they can get $10 million a year paychecks from the big telecoms that are putting in the hundreds of billions of dollars per every few years of equipment to spy on the American people. So here it is, April 11th, being reported by The Hill. Here it is being reported back in March 31st by the Daily Mail. Latest WikiLeaks release shows how the CIA used computer code to hide the origins of its hacking attacks and disguise them as Russian or Chinese. Ooh, I wonder where they got that in here. Oh. Was it Zero Hedge? WikiLeaks reveals Marble. Proof CIA disguised their hack attacks, Russia, Chinese, or Arabic? No. Is it the March 31st RT? No. Ladies and gentlemen, it's March 7th, Infowars.com, and we had articles before this. Vault 7, CIA can stage fake Russian hacking to undermine Trump. CIA kept Russian cyber attack techniques handy for false flags. Infowars.com. They did a 30-second search and found that one. I know we reported it before March 7th, but there's Infowars.com first, yet again. Why we're first among being attacked, why we're first being demonized, why Google, Facebook, Twitter, all of them admit they're strangling us, shutting off our advertising, not letting us advertise on Google, blocking us, our revenue's down 75% on Google ads, on YouTube, even though our traffic's way up. WikiLeaks comes out, we read it, we tell you, we break it down first. Another March 7th article, WikiLeaks, Vault 7 release confirms InfoWars decades of research. Then we have articles going back over 15 years giving you the specifics. Oh, by the way, Wired came out today and said that your thumbprint is not a good passcode for your iPhone and that it can easily be hacked and that it is even worse than a signature or a personal ID code. Told you that 20 plus years ago. Not bragging, you should understand, we're under attack as fake news because we're the opposite. We told you Trump was going to win. We told you there was fake polls. We told you the WMDs were fake. Oh, the New York Times is telling you that fingerprints aren't safe to get into your phones, and they're very easy to hack, and that if there's a digital signature that they can steal. And they told you last year, cover up your camera on your computer because it can watch and listen to you, and that they are doing it. Oh, I told you that in Libya, now that Al-Qaeda took over, they're selling people as sex slaves. Oh, my gosh. It's in the International Business Times today. Oh, my gosh. April, let's give them a Pulitzer Prize. Migrants are being sold at open slave markets in Libya. But a month ago, Stephen Colbert played clips of me, and so did others, where they said, oh, they sell women on top of slave blocks. And they made jokes about, what's a slave block? Well, they put you up on a pedestal so everybody gets a look at you, and they have the women take their clothes off so they can see it, then they sell you. But all these different shows attack and make jokes that I claim Muslims are selling sex slaves. Oh, but I'm right again. Everything I'm saying is easily verifiable. But this is what we're facing. And so if they can shut us down, they can shut you down. They say InfoWars is under criminal investigation by the FBI. They have Congressional Armed Services Committee hearings with no proof and say that we get our directives from the Russians. And so we need to be shut down, and that they've set up a Ministry of Truth that Obama signed into law December 6th of last year, a month before he left office, a month and a half. And it says the State Department and CIA will shut down independent media in America that is blocking their operations. And now they're going to call me a Russian agent again because Vladimir Putin has come out and said clearly the chemical attack was a false flag. We never do that. Just like they did a few years ago, they got caught. And then we have Ron Paul saying it, and we have the British ambassador saying it. Are we all Russian agents? I guess Putin is. So let's go ahead and play Vladimir Putin. Is Daria going to read the subtitles, or am I?
Oh, they're already there.
Okay, we got actually an evil Russian working here. U.S. Army veteran, the whole nine yards, but she can't be trusted. But here, she's going to read what Putin had to say. Here it is.
We have information from various sources that a similar provocation, and I can't call it anything other than a provocation, is being prepared in other parts of Syria, including the southern suburbs of Damascus, where they're again preparing to release some similar chemical substances and accuse the Syrian authorities of using them. But we regard that any such incident would be reason enough for a thorough investigation. We are preparing to make a formal call to the relevant UN agency in The Hague and call on the international community to investigate thoroughly these incidents. And depending on the results of the investigation, to make informed decisions and take meaningful action.
All right, let's go to the former British ambassador to Syria, Peter Ford, 2 days ago. saying that they've now given them plenty of excuses to stage more false flags.
And based on previous experience, including Iraq, we can see that we cannot take at face value what the so-called intelligence experts tell us, not when they have an agenda. But come back to the main point, that it's not going to end here, and we are likely, Britain, to be dragged into it, because Trump has just given the jihadis 1,000 reasons to stage fake flag operations. Seeing how successful and how easy it is with a gullible media to provoke the West into intemperate reactions, they will very likely stage an operation similar to what they did, and this was documented by the United Nations in August last year. They mounted a chlorine gas attack on civilians, and they tried to make it look like it was a regime operation. This, mark my words, you're hearing it here, and it will happen, and we'll get all the warmongers coming to tell us that Assad is defying us and we must go in more heavily into Syria. This will be fake flag.
Fake flag, a new term is coined. Better than false flags, the public can actually understand what that means. Meanwhile, I have the report I'm going to play in a few minutes. CNN attacked myself and others for saying that this was a false flag. And they always say that we have no proof. They don't actually show us with the proof. I'm going to play Ron Paul first. But it just illustrates the fact that the rebels have been caught red-handed once and at least three other times partially launching attacks on themselves. Once it blew up on them as they were preparing to launch it inside a city area. And they've done this before. So Putin rightfully is saying they'll probably detonate it in Aleppo or somewhere like Damascus in a suburb and then say it's ours. When this is Obama and now Trump's red line, and the Syrians are winning the war, why in the world would they launch it? Well, they say they have the track of the planes flying from that base over this village. The Russians say they bombed Al-Qaeda, ISIS, al-Nusra, and that it was chemicals on the ground that killed them. The media is also saying that we say no chemical attack happened. No, I believe 80-something people died from a chemical attack. But I want to ask again, why were we all shown the images of dead kids when we never see the images of dead kids when it's jihadis running over people in London or in Luxembourg or in Stockholm, Sweden, or in Brussels, Belgium, or in Paris, France, or in Nice, or in Berlin, or in Cologne? You never see that. But you saw it here, didn't you? And when our missiles goes astray, And hit a village and killed four people. Do we see images of those dead kids? This is how they operate, ladies and gentlemen. So Ron Paul came out first. We came out first. We had an article day one with our sources in Syria with the jihadis celebrating. Let's show Syrian Girl's article, if we can, that it was a false flag. We had the first article, and then we showed the jihadis celebrating that they'd done it. Because, see, they get paid by Saudi Arabia for this. So they want to show they did it and just hope our media covers it up for them. Report, Soros linked group behind chemical attack in Syria. It is a group he funds. Chemical attack has all the hallmarks of a false flag. The media makes jokes about that. Ladies and gentlemen, George Soros admittedly funded the Arab Spring. He admittedly funded the overthrow of Ukraine and their elected government. He's hardcore. He's crashed major government's currencies. He's a James Bond villain in the real world. But the media makes jokes. Oh, the little sweet Soros, he says he would be behind it. George Soros, at age 15, was rounding up Jews by the thousands. He's a famous Nazi collaborator. If you're rounding up people, your own people, by the thousands and marching them off to death after you rob them when you're 15, what do you do when you're 87 or whatever he is? But the media again makes jokes. Oh, Alex Jones says it could be a false flag. I mean, Soros was demanding February 2nd that Trump overthrow Assad. The good news is Trump's coming out, as I told you yesterday, and saying, I don't want to no-fly zone. I don't want to widen this. I don't want to topple Assad. It's his surrogates that are doing it, and they've proven they're out of control. I don't believe it's a double message. like we've been hearing from Pechenik. I think Pechenik's right on most things, but Trump's told confidants and others that no, he doesn't want this, as he always said, but he wants to say nobody better use chemicals because we don't know who did it either way. And that's now what the Secretary of Defense has come out and said. He said, and so has the Secretary of State, we're doing this to deter chemicals. They were supposed to give up the chemicals, and the chemicals were at that base. Now, is that true? We don't know 100%. But I know from inside the White House what Trump believes. I told you first that he believes he's sending a message on chemical weapons, and now that's what they've said. They've come out again last night and today and said, do not use chemicals, anybody. Well, how do you deter, then, the rebels from staging false flags, fake flags, as the British ambassador called it? But notice, MSM won't show you Putin, the British ambassador, or Ron Paul. I guess Bill O'Reilly did a few nights ago and made fun of Ron Paul. That's it. No one else is showing serious statesmen that are respected. Say what you want about Putin. He's respected when the president of Russia says that they think it was staged and they think more is coming. That should be on our news. Let's go ahead and play Ron Paul from his own show last week. And we've got Ron Paul again on RT. In fact, I want to play both clips, but here's Ron Paul on his own program.
And who would benefit? It makes no sense, even if you were totally separate from this and take no sides of this, and you were just an analyst. It doesn't make any sense for Assad in these conditions to all of a sudden use poison gases. It's zero. I think it's zero chance that he would have done this, deliberately.
And we got one more clip of him on RT that's a lot longer, but we'll just play part of it right now where he basically says the same thing. So this is not kooky. This is what most people geopolitically believe and know, because you have a group that's been caught doing it before. They have the motive to do it again because it'll bring the United States in to kick out their enemy Assad. You have Al-Qaeda, ISIS, al-Nusra all celebrating day one since last Thursday of the strikes and giving them hope now. And they've had more attacks on U.S. camps inside Syria in the last few days as they get oxygen in their lungs in this civil war that we've now been injected into, that I supported because I wanted to end it by kicking Al-Qaeda and al-Nusra and these groups out. But that's not happening now, it looks like. So things are spiraling out of control. I'm going to cover China in the next segment, which is really the big enchilada. But right now, let's get back to Ron Paul's clip.
They needed a so-called excuse. They worked real hard. That is our government and their coalition, an excuse to go into Iraq so they concocted stories, all kinds of things. And that's what this is part of. I don't know why, if any of it is true, why they couldn't wait and take a look at it. You know, a few years ago in 2013, there were these similar stories that, didn't go anywhere because with a little bit of a pause, there was a resistance to it built up in our Congress as well as the American people. They thought it was all, a fraud and that nothing like that was happening. And right now, I just don't see how it could conceivably be what they claim, because it's helping ISIS. It's helping Al-Qaeda. Why? It's helping the enemy that we're supposed to at least be fighting.
That's right. Bingo. Total bingo. Everything there's total veritas. Who can deny it? Now, I'm going to play this and really try to not start it and stop it, because I want to come back and get into the North Korea situation with China that's probably 10 times bigger than this, but this is all illustrative of how our media deceives. Here's CNN trying to drive a wedge in Trump's main populist support base, trying to give us attention, hoping we do it more. I could care less about being on CNN. Trying to get us all to throw the baby out with the bathwater and be mad at Trump, when overall he's doing a great job domestically, and I understand why he did this to look strong, and he couldn't tell either way. And they also wanted to send a message to North Korea, and it seems like it's happened. And so we're going to start the clip now, and then we're going to come back with the rest of it on the other side. You know what? I'll go to the clip when we come back on the other side, just so we have plenty of time to get to it, and then I'll get into all the other big issues that we're facing. But alt-right turns on President Trump. We'll detail exactly what's happening there when we come back. First off, I talked earlier about how Google, Media Matters, the Democrats, Facebook, Twitter, YouTube, they're all bragging, hey, we've demonetized InfoWars 75%. Paul's got all the graphs. He's broken that down last week. They're bragging how they kicked us off Google Ads via AdRoll. They brag how they're not letting, they're age restricting us, and you know, just mild videos that we covered that would never be age restricted on CNN. They are strangling us 100 different ways, basically, and admitting it. Understand, they've sold this to the left that, oh, it's cute and fun if we shut up the nationalists, the patriots, what they call the alt-right. That's a form of dehumanization. I'm not the alt-right. I'm a libertarian who really wants prosperity and freedom for everybody. I fight real racism. I fight real classism. I want prosperity. That's why I'm against this war expanding and all the rest of it. And that's why I'm critical of Trump. When Democrats wouldn't be critical of Hillary doing this, you can bet your bottom dollar. I have integrity. I have credibility. I don't get my funding from political parties or big corporations. I get it from listeners that support us and buy the products at InfoWarsStore.com. But we're able to finish funding ourselves with outside advertising, which they're trying to kill. Now, the good Lord's opened a lot of other windows to us to support us, so I'm very thankful. But if you're not spreading InfoWars.com articles, if you're not telling people, hey, this is the forbidden site, this is the cutting edge, this is the guy they want to arrest as a Ruski because he actually cares about the country and really is moral, this is the guy they physically attack, this is, you know, if you want us to win, understand we're fighting for you. And we need you to spread the word, to pray for us, and to financially go to InfoWarsStore.com and buy some of the great products you need. Sign up for AutoShip and get 10% off. And that way you know you're committed and get a big discount. We'll be right back.
Last week, Bashar al-Assad's regime killed even more of its own people using chemical weapons. Our missile strike in response to his repeated use of banned weapons was necessary as a matter of U.S. national security interest. We do not want the regime's uncontrolled stockpile of chemical weapons to fall into the hands of ISIS or other terrorist groups who could and want to attack the United States or our allies. Nor can we accept the normalization of the use of chemical weapons by other actors or countries in Syria or elsewhere. The U.S. is grateful for the statements of all of our partners who have expressed support for our timely and proportional response. As events shift, the United States will continue to evaluate its strategic options and opportunities to de-escalate violence across Syria. Many nations look to the Geneva process to resolve the Syrian conflict in a way that produces stability and gives the Syrian people the opportunity to determine their own political future. And our hope is Bashar al-Assad will not be a part of that future. If the Astana ceasefire negotiations become effective towards achieving a durable ceasefire, then the Geneva process has the opportunity to accelerate. To date, Astana has not produced much progress. It is also clear Russia has failed to uphold the agreements that have been entered into under multiple UN Security Council resolutions. These agreements stipulated Russia as the guarantor of a Syria free of chemical weapons, that they would also locate, secure, and destroy all such armaments in Syria. Stockpiles and continued use demonstrate that Russia has failed in its responsibility to deliver on its 2013 commitment. It is unclear whether Russia failed to take this obligation seriously or Russia has been incompetent. But this distinction doesn't much matter to the dead. We can't let this happen again.
I'm really proud of InfoWars and our team and our sources because you notice I said on Thursday and Friday, I didn't know exactly what was going on, but we laid out the best info that was out there. And then over the weekend, I filed reports telling you exactly what was happening. And on Monday, Paul Watson put a report out that President Trump is resisting neocon calls for a no-fly zone and a wider war. We can put that article back up on screen. Some of that article is word for word what the president said in meetings. I had that from one source. And then it was what was said in a telephone conversation with another person who I called and checked with. I mean, I have my White House sources. We get White House memos. We get a lot of stuff that the rest of the media doesn't get. And so the president, by the weekend, understood that some of his surrogates and others were running wild, pushing a war narrative. So he began to put out the narrative that we're not doing a no-fly zone. We're following the old plan. Bashar al-Assad was supposed to step down after we kicked out al-Qaeda and ISIS. We've got a force there to let him know that he should open up what he said he would do 4 years ago to have elections once al-Qaeda and ISIS is out of the area. And it was also a strong message that nobody better be using chemical weapons. And why weren't those weapons still shipped out of the country? And it was an even bigger message to China, and of course to North Korea, who are threatening everybody and are a serious threat, 50 times worse than what's happening in Syria. Syria is not a threat to the United States. Having a war with Russia over it is. So again, who started the war? The Clinton-controlled Obama neocon-run Obama White House. That's a fact. And so it's our mess. And I get Trump says he owns it now. He wants to fix it. And I believe the president. He wants prosperity. He doesn't want a bunch of wars. But we have to have peace through strength. Syria could become a U.S.-Russian proxy war. Absolutely. That's what the experts are saying. It's already been a proxy war for 6 years. And Russia has the moral high ground. I'm not a Russophile. I'm not an Anglophile. I'm not an EU-file. I'm an American-file. I'm an Americana guy. I love America. I want our sovereignty. I want our taxes cut. I want better deals. Trump has crippled Russia by saying coal's back on the table. That drove down their natural gas prices by half in one day. We're not against Russia. One of the few things Nikki Haley said that's true is Trump strengthening our military and driving down energy prices in Europe. We've got these new super ships that are giant gas tankers. One of those ships loaded has enough gas for a major city like London for a year. It's just insane the amount of liquid gas we've got. So again, ladies and gentlemen, putting coal back on there drove down the prices of natural gas. Quite frankly, it hurt American consumers as well. But coal outweighs all that for our overall energy prices. So that's, when I say consumers, I mean people selling gas. I should say producers. But that wasn't enough when Nikki Haley was at the Women's World Group bad-mouthing Russia. They booed. They want more. They're liberal women that listen to NPR. And you listen to NPR, it's like the anti-Russia channel. It's crazy. Okay. But what Rex Tillerson said is very, very encouraging and is word for word what I told you in a memo Sunday on the live show. And when I told you on Monday in Paul Watson's article, that is a transcript, that article he wrote that I gave him. And a good three paragraphs are directly out of the president's mouth. And I'm going to stop right there. Now, Michael Savage believes Trump has made a mistake. I respect Michael Savage. He's one of the smartest people on talk radio. Maybe he's right. Savage certainly knows his audience is against it. My audience is about 80% against it. All I'm saying is, let's not drive a wedge. Let's not let the left come in and make Trump think he's lost his base so that he has to compromise with the globalists and give in when on trade and borders and security and free speech and killing TPP, he is doing amazing things. He's bringing Glass-Steagall back, banking regulation, so the big banks can't sit there and create derivatives. And now let's go to the CNN piece I mentioned. Alt-right turns on President Trump. The alt-right deplorable crowd who voted in literally Hitler are turning on Trump because he punished a leader for using chemical weapons on innocent civilians. Okay, where's your proof? You have rebels caught doing it. You have ambassadors and former congresspeople and world leaders saying that it's a false flag, that Russia would never be involved in this. You have the neocons and the warmongering liberals calling for war with Russia. How's that for peace? And then you've got CNN taking snippets out of context to make it look like everybody's turned on Trump when Cernovich has been on air since Friday saying, no, he supports Trump. He just doesn't support the people giving him bad info, just like our other guests have said. And Paul Watson is off the Trump train when it comes to geopolitics, not off the Trump train completely. And I never said I was off the Trump train. Thank God for Trump. Let's just celebrate that globalism is being exposed all over the world. Le Pen is in the lead to win. She was against this strike, by the way. and that great things are happening worldwide and that Trump already got a good Supreme Court justice in. And let's just thank God for how we move the ball down the field. And we don't know everything Trump knows. It'd be so easy for me to just sit here and go, oh, yeah, Trump's horrible. He sold us out. He's all bad. And then we all turn away from politics, turn away when we've got critical battles on more Supreme Court nominees, on getting the tax cuts we want, on getting Obamacare repealed that now Rand Paul's honchoing, and all these other great things when he's done so much. $3 trillion in the stock market, $300 billion in new jobs announced, hundreds of major companies coming back. Do I need to announce all this? Saying that the extremist bureau of the FBI isn't going to target Americans and patriots and only focus on radical Islam. Exposing the fact that they won't expose radical Islam. Trying to block people from seven unvetted countries who don't even have real passports. Failed states like Libya and Sudan and Somalia, where they sell women on slave auction blocks, and where we have, who's that Oliver guy? And I forget all their names, the late night guys. And Colbert, they've all made jokes like, what's a slave block? And Jones claims that slavery's still going on. It's sick. It's sick. When I have it in the news today, International Business Times, there's video coming up. Migrants are being sold at open slave markets in Libya. I'm just informed, folks. I know so many men that are as smart as I am, but you go to their house, they've got all these footballs, all these baseballs, all these jerseys. All they want to talk to you about is football games. And do you want to go to the World Series with them? Do you want to go play golf with them? And I go, I'm going to spend time with my children, or I'm going to hike, I'm going to swim, I'm going to barbecue, I'm going to be involved in charities because that makes me feel good, just at an instinctive level, to be giving back. And I can't live in a fantasy world. You know what Babe Ruth hit in 1937. You know what Strawberry hit, you know, in 1972 or whatever. I mean, you know what Nolan Ryan did in, you know, 1991. I'm sorry. It's not that I don't like baseball. I start watching and I'll end up being obsessed with it. I played baseball. We're about to have nuclear war with North Korea. I got children, folks. I'm a normal man that men are designed to understand factoids and information and stats and topography and all this knowledge we have to build things, to create a civilization, but also to analyze threats. And so that's what I do. And I built InfoWars to take on the globalists that I knew were trying to take over our country and destroy our freedoms. And look what one man did in 22 years interfacing with other men and women and listeners who cared. Look what we built with this little focal point. That's why they're so scared of what we do. That's why we need your prayers. We need your support. Because the enemy knows we're the tip of the spear. They know we're walking point. And I'm here telling you. Do I have any respect with anybody out there that Trump overall is good? They hate him. He would never have done the things he did. It's irrevocable. His defeat of the media discredits them. They totally hate him. The things he's able to do, the things he's gotten done are seismic. I'm getting the biggest chills of my life right now. I know in my gut that Trump's for real. Can he be compromised? Can he be manipulated? Could he be killed? Absolutely. Can he go sideways? Can he get confused? Is he 70 years old? Absolutely. But it isn't about Trump. It's about us. And we can't sit there, whether he goes forward or sideways or backwards, and make it all about him. We got to make it about what are we doing in city councils? What are we doing in legislatures? What are we doing on air? Have you started a YouTube channel? Have you started your own blog talk radio? Have you started your own local access show? Maybe used to be in radio. Have you gone and told local stations, I want to do a show and I'm going to get some sponsors? Where's your hunger? Don't just say, thank God Alex Jones is there, and then not stand up. I need you, no matter whether you got black skin, brown skin, red skin, pink skin. You got red blood. I don't care if you're a man, a woman, whatever. To have some energy and to take action and to focus on the globalists and what they're doing. Trump's not the enemy. Trump's imperfect, but he's already moved the ball down the field and won some major victories. We don't rise and fall with him or Le Pen. Or Farage, or Matt Drudge, or Alex Jones, or anybody else. We rise and fall on you and your relationship with God and your will to take action against evil. So here's CNN celebrating. Oh, the alt-right's mad. Oh, the alt-right's, you know, Well, you know what? At least we have a conscience. Let's play the clip. Here it is.
President Donald Trump ordering a military strike in Syria was like a punch to the gut for the alt-right, a group of Trump's most loyal supporters who, in part, voted for him because of his anti-war stance. The alt-right's anger on display in a storm of online tweets. Trump's base of support is gone if he goes to war with Syria, wrote blogger and author Mike Cernovich, just as the strike on Syria was beginning.
These people are totally turning on Trump.
Alex Jones, founder of the conspiracy-driven InfoWars website, said after the strikes he'd give Trump the benefit of the doubt, but still tweeted, "We are closer to the start of World War III than we have been in decades," along with the hashtag, "No War in Syria." In a separate tweet, he asked if Trump's strike on Syria was a sign of betrayal. And then this question, Trump train headed to destination disappointment, hashtag Syria strikes.
I asked the question, why would Trump hit a chemical weapons depot with thousands of tons of chemicals?
InfoWars editor Paul Joseph Watson also railed against Trump, tweeting, I guess Trump wasn't Putin's puppet after all. I'm officially off the Trump train. Right-wing commentator Ann Coulter, who campaigned for Trump, tweeted her dismay. Those who wanted us meddling in the Middle East voted for other candidates. And this reminder, Trump campaigned on not getting involved in Mideast, said it always helps our enemies and creates more refugees. Then he saw a picture on TV. Even as far back as 2013, Trump said he was against U.S. involvement in the Middle East. He tweeted then that Obama should save his powder, pleading with him, do not attack Syria. This tweet from a veteran to Donald Trump was a clear sign his supporters had lost patience with his predecessors and perhaps him too. It reads, no more regime changes, no more American dead, no more nation building. It's what you ran on. Even before the U.S. strike, some of Trump's alt-right base were even selling the idea that the chemical attack on the Syrian people was a hoax. Blogger Mike Cernovich started the hashtag Syria.
Hit pause, back it up a second. Michael Savage has come out. I'm going to post on Infowars.com. Michael Savage turns on Trump, says Syrian gas attack was a false flag. Well, I love Michael. Notice we said it last Wednesday, and we had the first article out on it. Just want to point out, we're the trailblazers. That's why we're under attack. Just like we exposed the CIA planning evidence of Russian stuff. We told you that months before. It was in the Hill today. Let's go back to the piece.
The idea that the chemical attack on the Syrian people was a hoax. Blogger Mike Cernovich started the hashtag Syria hoax, and InfoWars began referring to the attack as a false flag, suggesting it was only meant to draw the United States
first
into a war. The hashtag Syria hoax was reportedly an attempt to convince Trump to stay out of Syria. When he didn't, to make his point, blogger Mike Cernovich stayed live online for 11 hours, slamming Trump's decision.
If we're going to war with Syria, I'm moving to Argentina. If Trump is going to bring us to war, then that means there's no hope for America.
No hope for America, or no hope for alt-right Trump supporters who may suddenly be wondering if their president is a dove or a hawk.
So now the most demonized group in America, coined by Hillary Clinton and my dark heart, remember dark heart speech or alt-right, what was the dark heart speech? Now the worst people in America are against World War III, and we made up false flag, even though Ron Paul, Vladimir Putin, the British ambassador, everybody else are coming out. Michael Savage is saying it's a false flag. We're all evil, and you're all the good moral Democrats that want war. Yay! You can watch your white helmet shows on Netflix. Now, next hour, I'm going to be a good boy. I appreciate callers calling in and then holding. I'm going to take your phone calls on the state of the world and the situation in Korea or Syria, whatever area you'd like to get to, what you think of Trump, but also what you think we should push for in the agenda, the lower taxes, controlling our borders. We should also talk about the things we're thankful for. If we're going to attack Trump, then let's also talk about what he's done that's good. Because believe me, if Hillary was in right now, they'd already have their new Supreme Court justice in, and they would have their way with the American people on the Second Amendment, on taxes, on everything you can imagine. So let's thank God for the reprieves we've gotten. We have come so far from where we were just 5 years ago. Just five, 6 years ago, the public didn't know the Federal Reserve was private. They didn't know about global government. All of it's admitted now. And once it's out in the open that a foreign world government's running things or the EU's not elected, then they are forced to go to force with the head of the EU, Juncker, the Nazi heir, saying, I will invade you. I will take you over. I will break up America. I am in charge. You will submit to me. Good. Go ahead and try it. So that's all coming up, ladies and gentlemen. I'm going to kick the next hour off with the huge news in China. It is so over the top with North Korea threatening to nuke our carrier task force. They're the ones taking over the South China Sea. They're the ones boarding ships. They're the ones threatening to attack countries. Under international law, the United States could nuke China and Korea right now. The media says I'm calling for that. No, I'm not. But we have a first strike doctrine. If somebody aims missiles at us and says they may hit us first. You point a gun at somebody, you put your finger on the trigger, and you say, I'm going to shoot you. I have every damn right in the world to pull my gun and shoot you. I don't want to have a nuclear war, CNN, right-wing watch, all you other liars. There it is. Reuters, Fox News, recent developments surrounding the South China Sea. Let's go back and show them that headline. With North Korea threatening to nuke the task force. There it is. North Korea. State media warns of nuclear strike and provoked as U.S. warships approach. We ought to arrest Hillary and Bill right now. They're the ones that signed off and got personal money for transferring the nuclear reactors to them in the mid-1990s. That was all over the news at the time. But because I have a memory that's 22 years back from 1995-96, I'm a conspiracy theorist. We told you before it was in the WikiLeaks the CIA was staging fake cyber attacks on the U.S. How do we know? Cyber Command 6 years ago admitted they were launching fake cyber attacks to get agencies to go along with it. That's how arrogant they are. All right, let me just stop there. We need your support. We need your prayers. We're running a special I've never seen. I saw this today. I don't know who came up with this because our profit on these is less than 40%. They are offering the InfoWars Flash Special. Get the ProPure Nomad Water Filtration System. This cuts all the garbage out, folks, for 40% off at InfoWarsStore.com. We are launching an unprecedented 40% off mega special on the Pro Pure amazing super high quality gravity fed Nomad gravity water filtration system at InfoWarsStore.com for a limited time. Yeah, I don't know how they're doing this. This is the most versatile system from Pro Pure that uses high powered water filtration technology to eliminate everything from pesticides to chlorine to sodium fluoride. With millions of gallons of toxic sludge dumped in our waterways by the EPA and sodium fluoride added to the water supply, having a high-quality water filter is essential. Filter out chlorine, pesticides, herbicides, sodium fluoride, other toxic compounds with the Pro Pure Nomad for 40% off. Visit InfoWarsStore.com today and take advantage of the unprecedented special while supplies last. InfoWarsStore.com. And again, we don't raise it 40% like other companies get caught doing and then lower it the next day. That's 40% off the regular price. It's a super deal. At 216 smackers, okay? At $129, nothing is even close. I happen to know, I think we're buying those for like $120. So this is a loss leader, five-star review, a perfect five-star review. InfoWarsStore.com, a bunch of other specials today only. Shop with us. We need the support.